Sacred tent of Jehovah, right? His dwelling place, his tent. Now, a few videos ago, when I first started talking about Psalm 127, where we were talking about the Lord's house, and I started talking about our new bodies and the like, I was led to, and whether we're going to get a new one or whether the old one's going to be transformed, right? And I was led to these scriptures in 1 Corinthians 5. For we know that if our earthly house of this tabernacle, right? So Paul's talking about, he's directly saying that our earthly bottle, our earthen, our bodies, our fleshly bodies are our earthly house and it's our tabernacle, right? And it's Greek word G4636. We only see it the two times, but it's a tabernacle, a tent, a metaphor of the body of man in which, get this, in which the soul dwells as in a tent and which is taken down at death. Right? Check this out. So we come back into Isaiah 33 and this tabernacle shall never be taken down. This for me is the eternal body, is the glorious new body, is the body of the Lord Jesus Christ. It is the body of Christ, the everlasting covenant, right? The everlasting covenant. So that word tabernacle, it pertains, and it's never going to be taken down. That tabernacle is never going to be taken down. Never going to be taken down. That word tabernacle, it pertains to a tent, a man's dwelling place, and this translation of the word tabernacle gives us of the body of man in which the soul dwells as a tent and which is taken down at death, our earthen bottles, right, our fleshly bodies. Surely this is connected. But it also gives us in the Strong's Greek word G4633, of which we see the 20 times, and this is a word that I've shared quite a few times now. We get it as tabernacle 19 times, and we also get habitation, tent, tabernacle, made of green boughs or skins or other materials. of that well-known movable temple of God after the pattern of which the temple at Jerusalem was built. So this for me is this is the companion word in the Old Testament of Hebrew word H168, of the sacred tent of Jehovah, the tabernacle, and it's a nomad's tent, and it's a dwelling, home, a habitation. But this one here, for me, it's pertaining to this here, right? So this is that, it's the companion word, it's the Greek word of the Hebrew word, the closest I can see, right? Closest I can see. Now, this is a very interesting word indeed, because this is the word that we get in Hebrews 11, where we read that Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, they were the strangers and the pilgrims on the earth. And that word pilgrims, it pertains to a visitor from heaven. They probably didn't like the demon Jews.
Can I just stress that anti-vaxxers obviously live in another universe.
Thus, the demons were telling them they were from another universe, right? Because they're strangers and pilgrims on the earth, and that word pilgrims, it pertains to them being a visitor from heaven, just as I'm being led to think we are here, pre-existing beings, right? Pre-existing beings. I am just at fever pitch here. So here we're reading that they dwell in tabernacles, right? So they dwell in those tabernacles, and the eternal tabernacle is never going to be taken down. And in the New Testament, Paul's telling us that man dwells in their tabernacles, and that's pertaining to the body of man, which is taken down at death, right? Which is taken down at death, and this one will never be taken down, because this is the eternal body. This is the eternal body. This is the temporary body, the carnal body that gets taken down at death. It's giving us G4633, which is the word that tells us the strangers and the pilgrims on the earth, they're dwelling in their tabernacles, right? So they're temporary carnal bodies, the visitors from heaven. They're temporary carnal bodies. And for me, this is the companion word of this Hebrew word for tent that we're seeing in Isaiah is never going to be taken down. It's never going to be taken down, right? So this Greek word, it's a very exciting word indeed, because this is the word where Simon Peter, for me, he knew how to make them, because that's his reaction when he sees the transfigured Lord Jesus Christ. So when he sees the transfigured Lord Jesus Christ, I'm being led to think in his eternal body, the tabernacle that shall never be taken down, Simon Peter wants to make him a tabernacle that gets taken down, because he's seen him in his transfigured body, right? That's what I'm being led to think. So what does this mean? What does this actually mean, right? And, of course, it's the Hebrew word that I'm talking about here in Hebrews 11, dwelling in the tabernacles, the strangers and the pilgrims on the earth. And in Acts 7, we read that they had the tabernacle of witness in the wilderness, but they took up the tabernacle of Molech, because I'm being led to think that they were making giants. They were making giants in the valley of the son of Hinnom, right? But here in Acts 15:16, after this will I return and will build up again the tabernacle of David, which is fallen down, and I will build again the ruins thereof, and I will set it up. And back here in Isaiah 33, we're reading that the eternal tabernacle, well, it shall never be taken down, because the tabernacle of David has been built up again. So it was taken down, because it was the temporary carnal body that we're reading here in Corinthians. It gets taken down. It's the carnal body. My fever pitch here. What a connection, right? What a connection. But here in Isaiah, for me, absolutely, we're getting a manifestation of people dwelling in Zion, because we've got the sinners in Zion are afraid. So we've got sinning bodies in Zion, and Zion is the place where the spirits of just men made perfect are going. So we've got sin going on here in Zion, and in verse 20, for me, that would be connected, because we've got sin, and sin is death. Sin is the mortal body. Sin is death, And in verse 20, we're going to have the eternal Zion, where the tabernacle, it's never going to be broken down, where this, in the Old Testament, due to sin, that tabernacle has been broken down. The old, the law, sin, and death. But in the new, that tabernacle shall never be taken down. But absolutely, here in Isaiah 33, we're getting a manifestation of entities dwelling in Zion, sinning entities. And then in Psalm 76 we get, in Judah is God known, his name is great in Israel. In Salem also is his tabernacle and his dwelling place in Zion, the heavenly Jerusalem, where the spirits of just men made perfect come into. So for me here, we're absolutely seeing, I'm seeing that the Lord here, his dwelling place is in Zion, and that's where his tabernacle is, right? So what's a tabernacle? What's a tabernacle? But it's in, for me, it's in Mount Zion. In Salem also is his tabernacle. The heavenly Jerusalem, Mount Zion, where we're coming into the innumerable company of angels, right? The spirits of just men made perfect. Salem, the Lord's dwelling place, is in Zion. In Isaiah 33, we're reading that Jerusalem's going to be a quiet habitation, a tabernacle that shall not be taken down, and being led to think the tabernacle of David, that the Lord Jesus Christ is going to rule in. That tabernacle is the Lord's dwelling place in Zion, right? And we've got sinners in Zion, and we've got the Lord Jesus Christ. He's going to rend Zion away from the Old Testament Israel. And in 1 Chronicles 11, that was the city of David. As David, he appoints an archangel, Joab, the captain, over the celestial bodies. And there's something I really, really want to share about these stairs of David as well, that I just want to stay on track at the moment. It's one of many things I want to share right now. I just want to stay on track just for a minute. So much, right? So much coming in right now that I want to share. But for me here, we're seeing David's in the heavenly Jerusalem, Mount Zion, the heavenly Jerusalem for me. And that's why, and that's how he's appointing his archangel. He's captain over the host. He's prince. Joab, he's in Mount Zion. He's in Mount Zion, the heavenly Jerusalem. So for me, there's absolutely people that are dwelling in Zion. And for me, it's absolutely, I'm absolutely being led to think it's the heavenly Jerusalem. And unless there's two Zions or something that I'm not seeing here, that's where they were. And the kingdom of heaven suffereth violence from the days of John the Baptist to now, right? And the stars fought in their courses against Caesarea. There was heavenly celestial wars going on right through this Old Testament. And it was Satan thinking he's higher than the stars of God, right? The stars of God. And how do I stay on track in this video right now? Because there is so much flooding through this mind of mine right now. But we absolutely see here that the church are going to be planted in the same land that the children of Israel inhabited in the Old Testament. And I will plant them in this land assuredly with my whole heart and with my whole soul, which is what is happening now. I feel it. I just feel love from the Holy Spirit. For thus saith the Lord, like as I brought all this great evil upon this people, right? So will I bring them all the good that I have promised them, which is 14 generations later, which is what's happening now to the church. So are we pre-existing beings? Did this happen to us? Did this happen to us? But this is talking about the Old Testament Israel, right? But it's talking about the church as well. This is a prophecy to the church. And fields shall be bought in this land, right? So, and men shall buy fields for money and subscribe evidences. So this for me potentially is going to everyone's office. Everybody has their own parcel of land, their earthen bottle, their earthen tabernacle, their land. And at the moment, the Holy Spirit is healing our land. our office. We're executing our office, and they are part of the field. Every man had their own parcel of land in the land of Canaan. They all made up. They were all stones in the greater house. In the greater house, as they executed their office, and they bought their fields for money, buying and selling talents again. That's what this might be pertaining to here. Perhaps, right? So the church are going to come in to the same land that the children of Israel inhabited in the Old Testament. For me, that's what this says. I will plant them in this land, right? I will bring them again into this place, right? So they're coming again. They're coming again, but this doesn't happen until at least 14 generations after. So there's so much more to consider, right? But this is the land of Canaan that, for me, Hebrews 3 is telling us is the rest of the Lord Jesus Christ, because we read these are the events of Numbers 13 and 14 that led to the children of Israel wandering in the wilderness, right? So the Holy Spirit swore in his wrath, they shall not enter into my rest, right? Take heed, brethren, lest there be any of you an evil heart of unbelief, right? So a heart of unbelief is an evil heart. So if you don't believe, it's evil. To me, that's significant just in itself. In departing from the living God, but exhort one another daily while it is called today, lest any of you be hardened through the deceitfulness of sin. Deceitfulness of sin, right? For we are made partakers of Christ if we hold the beginning of our confidence steadfast to the end. So we need to keep going, right? We need to continue. But this for me, I just want to stay on track. This for me is absolutely saying that the land of Canaan is absolutely the rest of the Lord Jesus Christ. And that's the land that the church are going to go to. And that's the same land that the Old Testament Israel inhabited. Now, I see that as a spiritual land absolutely now as we till the Lord's land here on planet Babylon. But for me, it goes to the everlasting kingdom as well. Because I know in my heart that the promise isn't here. We're not just going to be here for eternity where everything's evil and everything in our carnal flesh is a sin. To me, it's going to get a lot easier and a lot more natural where we're going, and that's where we're going to go into their own land, our own land. And it's not going to be a little sliver of land they call modern day Israel. It's not that. Long past that, right? And make them one nation. So this is talking about the divided nation in the Old Testament, which makes me think even more about what this actually means in the everlasting covenant. The Judah and Israel are going to come together, and that's going to be the church. I will say the house of Israel, right? The house of Judah with the seed of man and the seed of beast. So these two nations that were divided are going to become one nation, and they're going to be made up of the seed of man and the seed of beast. And the seed of beast, of course, being the Gentiles. And we got that difference in Acts 15 between men and Gentiles, right? What's a man? What's a Gentile? What's a Jew? And what's an angel? So far from being resolved in this house, these questions, it ain't funny. One king shall be king to them all. Now, this is Ezekiel. So in terms of time, as we see and understand time today, but as I've been putting down, there's something about time in those scriptures. But if we just apply time as our understanding of time today, David's long dead. He's long dead. This is during the captivity. This is during the captivity. And there was 14 generations from David to the captivity. So this is long, long, long after David lived. And he's long, long dead, right? So who's this king? This king for me is, it would be the Lord Jesus Christ, right? But in verse 24, and David, my servant, shall be king over them, and they shall have one shepherd, right? So David's going to be the king, despite David being long, long dead. David is long dead. And for me, this is the Lord Jesus Christ. And in this psalm, we're reading, though I walk in the midst of trouble, you will revive me, right? And here we're getting David, who's long dead, he's going to be the king over the church, and the one shepherd for me is the Lord Jesus Christ, but he's the king as well. So is this saying that David's going to be both the king and the shepherd, and that's the Lord Jesus Christ, and he is the root and the offspring of David? It's like, I don't know, another entity is growing out of the same root of the tree. So I look at trees on the earth today, and the tree gets knocked down, but the roots are still in the ground, and then the new tree grows, but that tree's never as strong as the old tree for me. But the Lord Jesus Christ, he's total strength, he's perfection, but he's growing out of that same root. He's the root and offspring of David. So, and he's also the morning star. He's also the morning star. So it goes to the celestial as well, right? So it's like, I don't know, two people grow out of the same root of the same tree. And we get it again in verse 25. And they shall dwell in the land that I have given unto Jacob my servant, wherein your fathers have dwelt. So that goes to the church again. And they shall dwell in the land that I have given unto Jacob my servant, wherein your fathers have dwelt. And this is the everlasting covenant, the eternal shepherd, the eternal king. Even though it says the word David, they shall dwell there. So who's David, right? And what's his relationship with the Lord Jesus Christ? It's deep. Even they and their children and their children's children forever, right? The everlasting covenant. And my servant David shall be their prince, shall be their prince forever, right? So it's something very, very profound going on with David as we reflect on this scripture, where he will be revived. And that word revived, it goes to the quickening spirit. It goes to being born, being brought alive, to be revived. You were once dead and now you're alive once more, right? And then we get this one in Psalm 16, where on first observation of it, it looks to me like it's David talking to the Lord, and it's David talking about the Lord God. But here in Acts 2, we absolutely read that David was speaking about the resurrection of the Lord Jesus Christ. Because thou wilt not leave my soul in hell, neither will thou suffer thine Holy One to see corruption. Therefore, being a prophet and knowing that God hath sworn with an oath to him that the fruit of his loins, according to the flesh, he would raise up Christ to sit on his throne. He, seeing this before, spoke of the resurrection of Christ, that his soul was not left in hell, neither his flesh did see corruption. So this is telling me that both... we're both talking about the soul of the Lord Jesus Christ and the flesh of the Lord Jesus Christ. So in verse 27, because thou wilt not leave my soul, the Lord Jesus Christ's soul in hell, neither wilt thou suffer thine Holy One to see corruption, which is pertaining to the flesh of the Lord Jesus Christ. It's very, very interesting indeed, because the flesh of the Lord Jesus Christ, while he was dead, did not see corruption. And when he was resurrected, the disciples thought they'd seen a spirit. And Thomas, when he didn't believe, the Lord Jesus Christ said, touch me, for I am bone and flesh. So the Lord Jesus Christ was, they didn't know him. They didn't know it was Jesus. So he was in some sort of other state, but he took on a fleshly form. And we read here in Acts 2, that his flesh did not see corruption. So this here in Acts 2 tells us this in Psalm 16 is David talking about the Lord Jesus Christ. And it's another manifestation where I just see it that he is talking as though he is the Lord Jesus Christ. Preserve me, O God, for in thee do I put my trust. So as I say, when you first read this, If this is a prophecy to the Lord Jesus Christ, we're getting the word I, right? But Jesus didn't write it. David wrote it, right? But he's writing about the Lord Jesus Christ. O my soul, thou hast said unto the Lord, thou art my Lord, my goodness extendeth not to thee. So isn't this fascinating? Isn't this fascinating? So I'm being led to think here that David is talking like he is the Lord Jesus Christ. So these are the words of the Lord Jesus Christ. So Jesus says, preserve me, O God, for in thee do I put my trust. O my soul, thou hast said unto the Lord. So this for me, it's like I see that word thou, and it's like it's talking about somebody else. Because when you're speaking about yourself, you're not, it's not thou. Thou is, thou art the Lord. How art thou? It's talking to somebody else. So he's talking about his soul like it's somebody else. My soul, thou hast said unto the Lord, like it's somebody else, thou art my Lord. So I see this lower O-R-D here for Lord, and it's a different incarnation of the word. So the Lord is the Lord, and the Lord is Jesus's, David's soul, Jesus's soul. He's their Lord. He's their Lord. And it's saying, the psalmist, as David, is saying that somebody's goodness does not extend to somebody else. So this is talking about somebody else again. It could be talking about the soul again. So the soul is saying to Jehovah, thou art my Lord, and my goodness extends not to thee. The soul, it's very, very mysterious. I've never picked up on this one before. I've never noticed it before, but this is very mysterious indeed. O my soul, thou hast said unto the Lord, thou art my Lord, my goodness extendeth not to thee. Sometimes when I do these videos, and sometimes when I read scripture, I just see one and I just know I'm going to read this over and over again and try and get sense of it. This is quite a mystery. O my soul, thou hast said unto the Lord, thou art my Lord, my goodness extendeth not to thee. So I'm only seeing the Lord God, the Lord Jesus Christ, and David, and somebody's goodness is not extending to somebody else's goodness, and my goodness extendeth not to... Maybe it's the soul. The soul doesn't, the soul's goodness doesn't extend to the Lord God. Anyway, verse 3. But to the saints that are in the earth, and to the excellent in whom is all my delight. So the saints in the earth, right? Their sorrows shall be multiplied that hasten after another God. Their drink offerings of blood will I not offer, nor take up their names into my lips. Look at this one. The Lord is the portion of mine inheritance. So this is the Lord Jesus Christ, right? Because that's what we're getting in Acts 2. That David's talking, he's talking about the Lord Jesus Christ. He's speaking about the resurrection of Christ, that his soul was not left in hell, neither did his flesh see corruption. So that's what he's saying in verse 10, and it's still pertaining to my. But thy Holy One, that talks about a third person. But in Acts 2, that's telling us that neither did his flesh see corruption, as he speaks about the resurrection of Christ. So they both pertain to Jesus, right? So the Lord, so this is David writing, but it's Jesus writing, right? That's what Acts 2 is saying. So the Lord is the portion of the Lord Jesus Christ's inheritance. inheritance, right? So we're back into this word inheritance, and it's all coming back to this psalm and Exodus 15 and Jeremiah 32. And I thought I had some scripture to put down before, but my goodness gracious me, just sitting down and processing that last hour or so of video, where does one begin, right? Where does one begin? But this in verse 5 for me is telling me, the Lord is the portion of mine inheritance. So that's the church, right? So the Lord Jesus Christ's inheritance is the church. And in order for an inheritance to be inherited, somebody has to die, right? And the Lord Jesus Christ purchased the church with his blood, Acts 20, and we're going back there as well. And of my cup thou maintainest my lot. The lines are fallen unto me in pleasant places. Yea, I have a goodly heritage. I will bless the Lord who hath given me counsel. My reins also instruct me in the night seasons. I have set the Lord always before me, because he is at my right hand, I shall not be moved. Therefore, my heart is glad, and my glory rejoiceth. My flesh shall also rest in hope. For thou wilt not leave my soul in hell, neither wilt thou suffer thine Holy One to see corruption. Thou wilt show me the path of life. In thy presence is fullness of joy. At thy right hand there are pleasures forevermore. So Acts 2 is telling us that he's talking about the Lord Jesus Christ when he speaks about the soul not being left in hell, or neither is flesh seeing corruption. So that's, he's talking about the Lord Jesus Christ. So back here in Psalm 16, I look at this and it's written by the one talking about the one other, right? So in verse 10, this is the Lord Jesus Christ talking to the Lord God. For thou wilt not leave my soul in hell. Therefore my heart is glad and my glory rejoiceth. I have set the Lord always before me. So this is the Lord Jesus Christ talking to the Lord God, right? That's what I'm being led to think. But then we read, because he is at my right hand. So the Lord God is at the Lord Jesus Christ's right hand. It's very, very difficult to reconcile. It's very, very, very difficult to reconcile. So it's now the next day, right? It's now the next day. So it's now Tuesday, the 28th of September, 2021. It's about 4:30 in the afternoon here on the New South Wales Central Coast, planet Babylon. And what will I do? I think what I might do, because when I first started out on this video, this is what I wanted to do, was share the calendar that I got yesterday from Mum in Psalm, and then share the big one and also the little one, right? Also the little one. So I might do that now, because this is how these calendars work, because on and on it goes. So I was talking about talents given by the Lord so we can execute our office, and the more that's given, the more that's going to be required when we're judged. And the more you're given, the more you have to give. You have to. That word have to, right? That's the charge. You're expected to. But you want to. You want to, because that's where your heart leads. And that's certainly where my heart is right now, is that I just want to give back as much as I possibly can to the church. Because of this testimony, I'm just growing more and more confidence every day that the Lord not only will allow us to do this, to walk in this glorious gospel of peace, love and truth in this, just this hotbed of filth that is planet Babylon, he wants us to do it. That's the command. That's the charge from the Lord God. And apologies if you can hear a little bit of there's a guy that lives here. There's a guy that lives here across the road, and he's very, very animated with his language, and he's just so loud. He's just so loud, and you can't pick him. And when he tells people stories, he just does it with such ferocity. And a few times he's had to be reminded that there's ladies present, and he just, I don't know whether it's come up in the background or not. I apologise if it has. I've closed the door, and I hope now that we can't hear him, but he's very difficult not to hear sometimes. But anyway, I was talking about just how we execute our offices within the body of Christ, our talents that are given to us, the blessings that are given to us, right? Now, I got this one yesterday, so it's Tuesday now. I got this one yesterday, Monday the 27th of September, in 2 Corinthians 9:8. And God is able to make all grace abound towards you, right? So grace for me is, it pertains to talents given, the amount of grace, the amount of manna, the amount of ability that he gives us, the amount of responsibility puts on us. And God is able to make all grace abound towards you, that ye, always having all sufficiency in all things, may abound to every good work. Right, so it's just so loaded, because this is what I say. Not only will he allow us to do it, he wants us to do it. He's going to give us grace to do it, precious gifts, talents. The angels will keep charge so that we can abound to every good work, right? I laughed when I read it. I laughed because I was just absolutely blown away when I read it. I just, what? It was just a laugh of just utter disbelief, not a laugh of, it's funny. It was just like, this is just getting next level now. But then I got this one. In the little calendar, this is the main calendar, right? Which left me at fever pitch for a few reasons. Revelation 22:12. And this is a scripture that came in hard when, because I've had to deal, a part of my faith is dealing with everything. Everything that comes up, I deal with it. I remember when it started coming in that Paul was a false apostle, and it was just everywhere on my YouTube feed for a couple of weeks. And I had to test that, and I was certainly tempted by it, because these wolves, they put down very, very seductive words, right? But the Lord's always guided me. He always guides me into truth. I remember when I used to read the Apocrypha books, Enoch and Jasher, and the Lord just put it into me where there's just inconsistencies in those books, and I've never even been tempted to read them again, because to me they don't line up, right? So I've had to deal with it, and I want to deal with it, and this is what the Lord does. And now you don't have to deal with it ever again. I never, ever, ever have to even consider whether Paul's a false apostle or not, and ever again, because the Holy Spirit led me to deal with it, and I know why. I know why it's just false, and I know why there's a doctrine out there that want people to think that he is. Could you still imagine if Paul was a false apostle? So all of these glorious writings of Paul, he just preaches the gospel of peace, love, and truth from the rooftops. You imagine if that's all false? They just want you under the law, right? They want you back under the law. They want you back under bondage. They want you back under sin, knowing full well that you can't be saved. You can't be saved by doing the works of the flesh. We're all condemned under it, right? So it's a doctrine that makes sense. And another one is this whole, I hear this question, if you're once saved, are you always saved? For me, you shouldn't be asking that question. For me, it's a foolish question. Why would you ask that? You just keep going. The scriptures for me are very, very clear that we need to continue, right? We need to continue. And then they bring in predestination and all this sort of thing, and predestination is very, very real, but we don't know the outcome. The Lord does. So predestination is very, very real, but for those that reach the end, they're predestinated, right? But those that don't reach the end, well, they weren't. They weren't predestinated. So there's people out there now who probably think they're saved, once saved, always saved, and they think they're predestinated, but they're not, because they're not going to make it, right? So to me, it's predestination's as simple as that. It's about God knowing. And another one, with this once saved, always saved, is that they say that you don't have to do anything, that anything you do, you then get condemned for being in a works-based doctrine that you're trying to work your way to heaven. So again, they're accusing you of being back under the law, right? And for me, the scriptures are very, very clear again with we must work. And for me, that's what James is talking about, that I will show you my faith is manifest by the work that I do. And what's the work that I do? We walk in the gospel of peace, love, and truth. That's our works. That's what we do. That's what works are. Walking in the gospel of peace, love, and truth, because that's a manifestation of our faith as a result of our glorious testimonies, right? We know these things because of our testimonies and because of our faith. So we need to continue, and that's how our faith is made manifest, through our works, right? And this is a scripture where I didn't have to deal with this one for long, because I hear this, you call upon the name of the Lord and that's it. There's a scripture in Acts where I heard this crowd, they say it all the time. What don't people understand about all you got to do is call upon the name of the Lord and you'll be saved? And that's very, very true. But it's like bad analogy, but I'll use it. And if any analogy pales in any significance when it comes to the scriptures and the Holy Spirit. But I took my car to the mechanic the other day for that rego check. So if I had rung up to book that car in, well, I've called upon the name of that mechanic, right? So that now my car's past rego. But you've actually got to go in and you've got to do the work. It's like when your car breaks down, well, you just ring the mechanic and it'll be fixed. You ring the mechanic and it still won't start. You've actually got to take it there. You call upon the name of the Lord, and that's just the start. If you call upon the name of the Lord with a pure heart, He will save you, but it's a process. It's the progression of faith. It's the outcome of faith, and it ain't easy. It ain't easy, and you got to keep going, and you got to let the Holy Spirit lead you, right? And I saw that. This scripture just put that doctrine to bed in about 5 minutes, and it was Revelation 22:12, right? And behold, I come quickly, and my reward is with me, to give every man according as his work shall be. So the Lord's going to reward us by our works. And what are our works? That goes to the Lord's grace, right? That I got from the other calendar yesterday, that he's going to give us enough grace, and we're going to have sufficiency in all things. So those who gathered much had none over. Those who gathered little had enough. And that's what we're getting here, is that he gives us enough for our eating. If we get too much, we get puffed up. If we don't have enough, we think the Lord's forsaken us and that we're poor, right? So the Lord Jesus Christ gives us enough grace for us to execute our office, and he's going, and for more, to whom more is given, the more will be required, and he's going to judge us on how we execute our office. How about that, right? How about that? So I wanted that. Those are the three scriptures I wanted to put down at the start of this video. But what I'm going to do now is just keep going with this one, this Psalms one, because this word revive, and also this term right hand, right? So I ask thee what think of thee, and when I say that, it means I'm going to give you what I think as well. But what do you think when you hear this term right hand in the scriptures? And your right hand will save me. So what do you think that right hand is when you read it in the scriptures? For me, it's the Lord Jesus Christ, right? And we see scripture that I'm going to get to just a sec, which is just, for me, it's tying into the purchase and the planting and the inheritance and all those things I've been talking about. It's all starting to come together as a result. This video was not going to go this way at all. It's not where I was going. Well, I was going towards the inheritance, but this is just this is blowing my mind, that it's just seemingly bringing so many things together. And this is where I feel the videos could well be going for the next, who knows? It's pretty useless for me to have a plan. So the right hand for me is the Lord Jesus Christ. But the Lord Jesus Christ is now, he's now sitting at the Lord God's right hand until his enemies are made his footstool. So what are the enemies of the Lord Jesus Christ? For me, number one is sin and also death. For me, they're the same things. Sin causes death. And the last enemy, 1 Corinthians 15 tells us, the last enemy that's going to be destroyed is death, right? So the Lord Jesus Christ is going to sit on the Lord God's right hand until all his enemies are made his footstool. So all his enemies have been crushed under his feet. And here in Psalm 16, we're reading, I have set the Lord always before me because he is at my right hand. So it's quite significant, this. It's quite significant because the Lord Jesus Christ, I'm being led to think, is the right hand of the Lord. And then when he's resurrected, he's sitting at the Lord's right hand. So he's gone from being the Lord's right hand to sitting at his right hand. Now, on the earth today, we hear this term, the right-hand man. So somebody's got an assistant, their main dude, their main fella that helps them. It's called, they're called his right-hand man. So it could be pertaining to that, that the Lord Jesus Christ is the right-hand man of the Lord God, and that's potentially why he was his right hand, but now he's sitting at his right hand. Because for me, he seemed to have been a part of the Lord. He was actually his right hand, whereas now he's sitting at his right hand. But here in Psalm 16, we're reading that the Lord is at the right hand of who? Is this David or is this Jesus? For me, this is Jesus, because that's what verse 10 says. For thou wilt not leave my soul in hell, neither wilt thou suffer my Holy One to see corruption. And Acts 2 is telling us that David, he was writing about the Lord Jesus Christ. So David is writing like he's Jesus. So this is David writing, but he's saying my. He's saying me. He's saying the Lord is always before me, but this is Jesus. He's writing like he is the Lord Jesus Christ. So for me, Acts 2 pretty much says it. He's seeing this before spoke of the resurrection of Christ. So David knew. For me, David knew that about the resurrection. He did. He absolutely knew about the resurrection of the Lord Jesus Christ as he speaks in that Psalm 16, like he is. Like he is the Lord Jesus Christ, as we read here in Acts 2. So there's something so profound going on between David and the Lord Jesus Christ. It is just, it's blowing my mind. Now, how about this in Psalm 80, right? Check this one out. Give ear, O shepherd of Israel. So who's this? Who's this, right? So we come back into Ezekiel 37, and my servant David shall be king over them, and they shall have one shepherd. Right, so that could pertain to two. So David's going to be the king of Israel, but the Lord Jesus Christ is the king of Israel, right? And they shall have one shepherd, and that shepherd is the Lord Jesus Christ. But in Ezekiel 34, well, it is a lot more direct. In verse 23, and I will set up one shepherd. Now it's lowercase s, right? I will set up one shepherd over them. So it's not two, it's not three, it's one. It's one. There's only one. And who is that shepherd? And he shall feed them, even my servant David. He shall feed them, and he shall be their shepherd. And I, the Lord, will be their God, and my servant David, a prince among them, I, the Lord, have spoken it. So back in Ezekiel 37, we're reading that David is going to be the prince, David's going to be the king, And I'm being led to think David is going to be the shepherd. In Ezekiel 34, for me, we get it straightly. Look at verse 22, though. Therefore, I will save my flock. I will save my flock, right? So the body of Christ, my sheep know my voice. And they shall no more be a prey, and I will judge between cattle and cattle. So this also is very interesting indeed, because this is telling me that the Lord Jesus Christ's flock is not just sheep, and cattle are people as well. Cattle are absolutely people as well. And we come back into this Bible verse of the day where the Lord Jesus Christ is going to come quickly. His reward is with him, and he's going to give every man according to his work he shall be, as he saves his flock, the body of Christ, and he judges between cattle and cattle, and that's dependent on their office. The grace that the Lord Jesus Christ has put into every one of our offices, that there may be an equality. The talents he gives us, the gifts he gives us, what he charges us to do in his glorious body, he's going to judge us as he saves us, and he's going to judge between cattle and cattle, right? My. And I will set up one shepherd over them, and he shall feed them, even my servant David, he shall feed them, and he shall be their shepherd. And I, the Lord, will be their God, and my servant David, a prince among them, I, the Lord, have spoken it. Now, this just reminds me of Matthew 22, because in the New Testament, when the Lord Jesus Christ arrived, he must have just blown those people's minds with what he said. Because in Matthew 22, after he gives the two great commandments, and he says, thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all of thy heart and with all of thy soul and with all of thy might. Now, that's the first great commandment. So this is essential. You call upon the name of the Lord and then you will be saved. You have to do it with a pure heart and a pure heart. You have to want to know him. And then the second for me is an outcome. This is an outcome. For me, it's not my testimony that I love my neighbor as myself. I used to really struggle with this one. I used to think, love, are you kidding? All I see is evil everywhere, right? And everybody's always having a go at me. And are you joking? You just want people to walk all over me, right? But for me, this has been a progression. This has been a progression as the heart softens and you become, to me, because the Holy Spirit allows us to do it. For me, if the Holy Spirit didn't allow us to do it, there's no way I'd be in the state I'm in now. I'm just not that resilient where everybody's always being horrible and having a go and you just got to be la, 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 everything's fine. I just love everyone, you know. And to me, it's like I just can't sustain that. But given what he's done in my life and he's just allowed me to do it, and it's just become a joy to do it. It's just to go out there and just be nice to people with a pure heart and not want any ill upon anyone whatsoever. The Lord says that he doesn't want anyone to perish. He wants everyone to repent and be saved, right? And I feel exactly the same way. So for me, the first great commandment is essential to start. And the second great commandment to me is an outcome. On two of these great commandments hang all the law and the prophets. So for me, every single one of those laws that were given down, particularly the Ten Commandments, if you abide in those first two great commands, the rest become redundant. You don't even need them. And that's a big, big clue I'm being led to think as why we're no longer under the law. We're under grace, because it just becomes an outcome. You find you're not doing any of those things because of the progression of faith, that you're loving your neighbor as yourself as you get closer to Nathaniel, a true Israelite in whom is no guile, right? But the Lord Jesus Christ asks in verse 42, saying, what think ye of Christ, whose son is he? They say unto him, the son of David. And he saith unto them, how then can David in spirit call him Lord, saying, the Lord said unto my Lord, sit at my right hand till I make thine enemies thy footstool. If David then call him Lord, how is he his son? So this confirms that Psalm 110 was David writing about the Lord Jesus Christ, right? If David then call him Lord, how is he his son? So I find this very interesting indeed, because the Lord Jesus Christ, the question he puts to the Pharisees is, what think ye of Christ? Whose son is he? They say unto him, the son of David. Now we know that the Lord Jesus Christ is the Son of God. And this for me is why he was asking the question. It was about, it goes to faith. So we know that the Lord Jesus Christ is the Son of God. Now, we come into Matthew 1 and we read that the Lord Jesus Christ is in fact the Son of David. The book of the generation of Jesus Christ, the Son of David. But in verse 16, and Jacob begat Joseph, the husband of Mary, of whom was born Jesus, who is called Christ. Right, so it doesn't say here that Joseph is actually the father of Jesus. It just says that Joseph is the husband of the mother of the Lord Jesus Christ. But in Luke 3, it's a little bit different, because we read in verse 23, and Jesus himself began to be about 30 years of age, being, as was supposed, the son of Joseph, right? So we get this in brackets, as was supposed. So I read that and I'm being led to think that this means that people thought that the Lord Jesus Christ at that time was in fact the son of Joseph. So Luke 3 is telling us potentially that the Lord Jesus Christ is actually the son of Joseph. But here in Matthew 1, we read the Lord Jesus Christ is in fact the son of David. That's what Matthew 1:1 says. But in verse 16, we read that Jacob begat Joseph, and Joseph's the husband of Mary, of whom was born Jesus, who is the Christ. But in verse 18, we get this. Now, the birth of Jesus Christ was on this wise, when as his mother Mary was espoused to Joseph before they came together, right? Before they came together, she was found with child of the Holy Ghost. So this is quite fascinating for me, because the Lord Jesus Christ is the Holy Ghost, the Holy Spirit. But here we're reading that the Lord Jesus Christ, he's the child of the Holy Ghost. And we know that the Lord Jesus Christ, even though he's being referred to here as the son of David, and Luke 3 seems to be telling us, as was supposed, he was the son of Joseph. He's the son of God. We absolutely know he's the son of God. But here, he's the child of the Holy Ghost. So that's telling me that the Lord Jesus Christ is also the son of the Holy Ghost. But in verse 17, we read that all the generations from Abraham to David are 14 generations, and from David until the carrying away into Babylon are 14 generations, and from the carrying away into Babylon unto Christ are 14 generations. So it's 28 generations. It's 28 generations from David to the Lord Jesus Christ. So when I read this in Matthew 22, it gets very confounding, because Matthew 1:1 tells us that the Lord Jesus Christ is, in fact, the son of David. So the Lord Jesus Christ, he asked them, well, who do you say I am? And that's their answer. That's their answer. The Pharisees say, well, you're the son of David. It's exactly what Matthew 1:1 says. And the Lord Jesus Christ says to them, how then doth David in spirit call him Lord, saying, the Lord said unto my Lord. So this is the Lord, that the Lord God said to the Lord Jesus Christ, sit thou on my right hand till I make thine enemies thy footstool. If David then call him Lord, how is he his son? And no man was able to answer him a word, neither durst any man from that day forth ask him any more questions, right? So when he arrived on the scene, and they would have said, well, No, the scriptures is actually saying that David's going to be our shepherd and our king and our prince. So who are you? Like, what are these things that you're talking about? He would have just, for me, he would have just absolutely bamboozled them. He would have been, I would have been perplexed. Like, if you're a lover of the truth and a lover of scripture, this for me says David. But yet it's the Lord Jesus Christ. So there's something going on about David and Jesus, right? It's just so profound, so profound. So this in Psalm 80, who is it? It's Jesus, right? It has to be Jesus. But is it David? It's the thing. Who is it? Now, Psalm 80 is a psalm of Asp. Asp being the chief musician, and it was Asp who David delivered his first psalm to. Give ear, O shepherd of Israel, thou that leadest Joseph like a flock, thou that dwellest between the cherubims, shine forth. So that's who we're talking to here. Whoever dwells between the cherubims, that's who we're talking to. That is the shepherd of Israel here in Psalm 80. Now, in 2 Samuel 6, we read this. Again, David gathered together all the chosen men of Israel, 30,000. And David arose and went with all the people that were with him from Baal of Judah to bring up from thence the Ark of God, whose name is called by the name of the Lord of hosts, the Lord of the celestial bodies that dwelleth between the cherubims. So this, for me, absolutely rules out David, because David's gathered together all the chosen men of Israel and they've sought the Ark of God, whose name. So that's interesting as well, because we're going to bring up from thence, from this place in Judah, we're going to bring up from thence the Ark of God. The Ark of God is called by the name of the Lord of the celestial bodies that dwelleth between the cherubim. So this for me seems to be naming the Ark of God as the Lord of the celestial bodies. But we've got David here, right? We've got David. He's leading this charge. He's leading this call to bring up the Ark of God, whose name is by the name, he's called by the name of the Lord of the celestial bodies, and it's he that dwelleth between the cherubims. And in 2 Kings 19, where I'm being led to think, it's just what I think, and it's just where the scriptures are leading me, I'm being led to think this is a manifestation of Lucifer exalting himself above the stars of God, and this is the exalted cedar in Lebanon in Ezekiel 31. We're getting a manifestation of it here, because this scripture in verse 23 is very similar indeed to a scripture in Ezekiel 30:31, which is leaving me at fever pitch, that Lebanon is where Eden is. I'm being led to think that the Garden of Eden is Carmel, and all the trees of Eden are in Carmel, and there's and Eden is a greater place. The Garden of Eden is Carmel. Eden is actually Lebanon. Yes, it does seem strange. I've done videos on this previously. I just want to stay on track just for now, but I'm being absolutely led to think that Eden is Lebanon, and within Lebanon is Carmel. And that's Eden. And he planted the garden eastward in Eden, right? Now, we also read about the rage of the exalted cedar of Lebanon. I'm being led to think Lucifer. We hear about his rage as he goes in and as he goes out, right? So we're into this going in and going out again. And for me, this is pertaining to potentially going in and out of the house of the Lord. But it's, for me, it's absolutely going to the knowledge of good and evil, and that fight. And that fight that we fight today, the knowledge of good and evil, we do it in the gospel of peace, love and truth. But this, for me, in the Old Testament, for me, it pertains to again, the knowledge of good and evil, fighting that fight potentially to the pulling down of strongholds. And this is what Solomon asked for when the Lord appeared to him in 1 Kings 3. That's what he asked for. He asked for all of that wisdom and knowledge. because he was yet a little child and he didn't know yet how to go out or come in, and he needed that wisdom so he could judge, right? So I'm being led to think that we've got a raging Lucifer going on here, and he rages as he goes in and out, and this is a manifestation of him exalting himself above the stars of God, and he was the highest exalted cedar in Lebanon, and all the fowls had their nests, and they were under his shadow, right? And he was bright and he exalted himself. That's the backdrop I'm being led to think here. Now, when this is going on, Hezekiah prays before the Lord, and he says, O Lord God of Israel, which dwelleth between the cherubims, thou art the God, even thou alone, of all the kingdoms of the earth, thou hast made heaven and earth. And it's him who we fear, right? Because he controls the lot. So Hezekiah is telling us here that it's the Lord God of Israel who dwells between the cherubims. And here in 2 Samuel 6, we're reading that it's the Lord of the celestial bodies who dwells between the cherubims. So that's who we're talking about here in Psalm 80. We're talking about the Lord. We're talking about the Lord of the celestial bodies. Exactly what the difference is. There's one Lord. That's it. But I'm being led to think he's being made manifest in different ways in the Old Testament. He's the Lord of all flesh, and he's the Lord of the hosts, and he is the Lord God of everything. But for me, we see him in different incarnations. And I'm being led to think in Jeremiah 51, we actually get the Lord and the Lord of the celestial bodies having a conversation with each other. But just for now, I want to stay on track, because there is so much coming in right now, man, about this right hand and purchasing and money and parables. And I'll do this now. It's now a couple of days later. I've just returned yesterday from the park. I just did my video yesterday down in the park, and this is the first time that I've spoken on this video since then. I'm now up to Matthew 19, and it's the 1st of October, about 11 o'clock in the morning here on the New South Wales Central Coast.
Therefore, it pains me to announce that I have no option but to resign from the office of Premier. My resignation will take effect as soon as the New South Wales Liberal Party can elect a new parliamentary leader.
North Korea, planet Babylon, and it's a Friday morning, right? And the calendar is at it again. So the little one from Mum, right? I got this from Psalm 121:5, and talk about being encouraged that the Holy Spirit wants me to keep going on this path, right? Oh man, on this path. So, wow. Right. So the big calendar today, I got from Psalm 18:30. As for God, his way is perfect. Hallelujah. The word of the Lord is tried. He is a buckler to all those that trust in him. Right? Trust in him. And this is something else I want to talk about with the mark of the beast as well, because I feel as I'm heading back there, because where does the mark go, right? Where does the mark go in the mark of the beast? It goes in their right hand, right? It goes in their right hand. And I feel, and I am just busting at the moment to get to Revelation 13, but I've got a lot I want to get through before I get there, not least of all Exodus 15, and how I'm seeing that ties into Jeremiah 32. And when I've got so many things I've got to put down before I get to what I'm really, really excited about, because I feel as though I'm really going to have a good look at Revelation 13 here. But generally when I've got, because the lead up to it is so exciting, and that's how I've been brought here, and just the wages of sin and buying and selling and forgiveness and all of it, right? And how I feel so many things right now are tying in. I just feel like sitting here now and just blurting it all out, but I want to put it down exactly how the scriptures have led me here, and just these testimonies, and just it's just amazing, man. It is amazing. We talk about this for a confirmation, the Holy Spirit, just a coincidence, right? Just a coincidence in the calendar that I've been saying here for so long. is the calendar of the day, is the Bible verse of the day that speaks to me so much. And some days I feel as though Jesus is standing right there, right? It's got to be just a coincidence, doesn't it? It has to be just a coincidence that I get Psalm 121:5 this morning. The Lord is thy keeper. So I wonder if that's Hebrew word H8104. I haven't checked that yet. Keep the way of the tree of life, H8104 and H1870, right? The Lord is thy keeper. So it's interesting. He will keep us, and he will keep us in his way on that path, because his way is perfect, and he is a buckler to all those that trust in him to keep us on that narrow path, that the progression of faith, and that's what's going to save us in the day of wrath. That he's going to look at us, and we're not going to take the mark of the beast, because he's going to look at us and say, we're a true Israelite indeed, in whom is no God, because we've had the progression of faith, right? We've had so much. The Lord is thy keeper. The Lord is thy shade upon thy right hand, right? Check this out. The Lord is thy keeper. The Lord is thy shade upon thy right hand. And where is the mark of the beast going? In their right hand, right? In their right hand. Anyway, here in Psalm, we'll get there. I pray we'll get there. That's the plan. But I've said so many times previously, haven't I, that it's pretty useless for me to have a plan. So Psalm 80 for me is absolutely, we take in these other scriptures in 2 Samuel 6 that we're talking about the Lord of the celestial bodies. He dwells between the cherubims. And Hezekiah tells us in Kings, it's Kings 19, 2 Kings 19, Hezekiah tells us that it's the Lord God of Israel, it's he that dwells between the cherubims. So Psalm 80, for me, now it's clear. We can have that confidence that the shepherd of Israel, it's he that leads Joseph like a flock. He dwells between the cherubims. And the psalmist is here, requesting that the Lord God of Israel, the Lord of the celestial bodies, he shines forth. So we're talking about the Lord God of Israel. Before Ephraim and Benjamin and Manasseh, stir up thy strength and come and save us. Turn us again, O God, and cause thy face to shine, and we shall be saved. Right? The progression of faith. O Lord God of the outcome of faith. O Lord God of the celestial bodies. So that ties in with Samuel, the Lord of the celestial bodies, right? Oh, Lord God of the... And my goodness gracious me, this just reminds me now. No, I'll keep going. Just reminds me of Zechariah 13:7, where for me, it's telling... We'll go there. We'll actually go there, because this for me potentially is significant. Everything's significant at this point, right? So Zechariah 13:7 for me, we're reading about the two manifestations of the one entity, the Lord of the celestial bodies, the spirit and his fellow, the flesh. Awake, O sword, against my shepherd, right? So we're reading about the Lord of the celestial bodies. I'm being led to think that the spirit of the Lord Jesus Christ. Awake, O sword, against my shepherd, right? So now we're talking about the Lord Jesus Christ as the shepherd, and against the man that is my fellow. Now, this is the same Hebrew word as we read as neighbor in Leviticus 19. And another moment where I could potentially get off track, because I'm being led to think that Leviticus 19 was given down to higher entities who were meant to be guarding the souls of men, including judging their neighbor, potentially them in the flesh, the heavens, they judge the earth dweller. And for me, this word fellow is the same Hebrew word as that word neighbor, right? It's got me a fever picture on a few different levels, but just for now, stay on track, right? Because so much about this right hand and buying and selling, and because that's what the mark of the beast is, right? You can't buy or sell. And everything's a lie, right? I'm so excited. Everything's a lie. So what does the world want us to think about what the mark of the beast, what the consequence is going to be? That we can't go down to the shops, and we can't buy food, and we can't buy this, and we can't buy that. That's what everyone thinks. And everything's a lie, right? Everything's a lie. And I've been sitting here putting down the last couple of weeks that for me, buying and our gifts is money. It pertains to money. Our value, our estimation are our talents, are our abilities, are the amount of grace that the Lord Jesus Christ gives us. And then in Revelation 13, we're reading that they can't buy or sell. Now, that's the beast, right? That's the beast who causes that. But I'm being led to think, we read it right through, that the merchants and the king of Tyre and buying and selling, right? Buying and selling in the temple. The scripture, which scripture was it again? Mark 11 and Jeremiah 7, how their companion scriptures and the Lord Jesus Christ in his fury, the great tempest, he overthrows the table to them that bought and sold, right? That bought and sold. And I'm not, I've been saying it here for months. I'm not being led to think that it's just pertaining to a $20 note that these central banks and these horrible, evil Freemasons that are running the world today have got everyone under bondage for. It's not about that. I have a fever pitch this morning here on October 1 that the mark of the beast could be something completely different. But we will get there, right? We will get there. I'm just so excited, right? But in any case, this word fellow is the same Hebrew word as neighbor in Leviticus 19, where there should be judging their fellow. I'm being led to think the spirit judging the flesh, right? And this is what we get, because we're talking about the Lord of hosts, right? The H6635, just so excited. I'm full of beans, man. I am ready to roll. I went on my walk again this morning. That's 2 days in a row. I think I'm back walking again, and I'm full of beans. I feel so much better for it. I was just an idiot for stopping, right? Just an idiot for stopping. So much coming in. But this is the H6635 host, celestial bodies, right? So what's a host? So we look up there at nighttime, and they're stars. And the stars fought in their courses against Zara. And that word, 86635, it pertains to the stars, the sun, moon, and the stars, and also the armies of heaven. So angels, in Revelation, we read angels and stars are the same thing, but does that mean that they are all the time? So what's a spirit? Is a spirit, I read a scripture the other day that tells me that the spirit actually dwells inside a man. But we've also got these demonic entities today, these wandering stars, these wandering spirits who are inhabiting their host. So I'm being led to think that they potentially manifest in two ways. We see them up there as stars, but they also, this is where I'm being led, they also inhabit the houses of men, the unclean spirits. So are spirits stars? Are spirits angels? Are angels spirits? Are angels stars? Is there any difference? Are all three the same thing all the time? Or do we have some spirits that are stars that aren't stars? Do we have some angels that are stars that aren't stars, that are just something else, that are just spirits? Do angels take on a physical form? Beware Hebrews 13 to entertain strangers because you've entertained angels unawares in the past. And my testimony with that woman that led me to the church, right? I feel I entertained an angel that day. So what truly is a host? We know it's a celestial body, but is it also an angel? Is it also a spirit? Because in 1 Kings 22, these are some scriptures I've put down a few times, and I'll just put them down just briefly here now. Well, that's the point anyway. We read about all the host of heaven are standing by the Lord on his what? Look at this. On his right hand and on his left. This is the thing. It's just everywhere. It's absolutely everywhere. I'd completely forgotten in this chapter that we had on his right hand and on his left. So what does this mean? On his right hand and on his left, and the Bible verse of the day, he's going to be our shade upon our right hand, and that's where the mark of the beast is going, and the right hand, who's the right hand of the Lord? I'm being led to think it's the Lord Jesus Christ, right? So to me, the right hand seems to be a point of strength, perhaps. Maybe a point of strength, somebody's point of strength, because that's where the mark of the beast is going. So they're going to attack. They're going to attack the strong part. And the Lord Jesus Christ of a man's tabernacle, and the Lord Jesus Christ, he's the Lord's right hand, I'm being led to think, right? So who are they on the left? Because, and who are they on the right? I'm being led to think potentially the left could well be, we could be getting light and dark here, maybe. But we've got all the hosts of heaven, right? We've got all the hosts, all there. Every single last one of the host of heaven are before the Lord here. I'm being led to think the sun and the moon, even though it seems very, very strange, for me, that's what's going on here. Every single last one of the host are standing before the Lord here, in scenes that are very similar to Job 1 and 2, where the sons of God presented before the Lord, right? I'm being led to think that was just like this. They're all standing before the Lord, and the Lord used Satan to inflict Job, just like he's used this spirit to beguile the prophets that led to Ahab's demise, right? And the Lord said unto him, wherewith? And he said, I will go forth and be a lying spirit, right? So one of the hosts here, absolutely here, this for me is telling us that a host, at least one of these hosts, is a lying spirit. So the hosts are celestial bodies. 86635 is clear with that the hosts are made up of celestial bodies. That's a part of it. It might be all of it, stars, sun and moon. And there may be, so that's the thing. This spirit is a part of the host. So does that now mean this spirit is a celestial body, a star that we see at nighttime? And is it also an angel that's now gone into the tabernacles of all these prophets? Because the Lord has put a lying spirit in the mouth of all these prophets. So a singular spirit has gone into multiple entities. And Matthew 12 tells us that we can have multiple entities going into the one house, into the one man, right? So in Matthew 12, this is the question I'm asking. When the unclean spirit is gone out of the man, he walketh through dry places, seeking rest, and findeth none. And he saith, I will return into my house from whence I came out. And when he is come, he findeth it empty, swept, and garnished. Then goeth he and taketh with himself seven other spirits, more wicked than himself, and they enter in and dwell there. And the last state of that man is worse than the first, even so shall it be unto this wicked generation. So I'm being led to think that the Lord Jesus Christ here is talking to those people that are in front of him all that time ago, but he's also talking to us today. And that's why it's in scripture, because he's talking to everybody on the earth today, including the body of Christ, everybody. Probably more so than to the body of Christ, because we're the only ones that read scripture. But he's absolutely talking to all of mankind, and that's what I'm seeing. That's what I'm seeing, because we see this thing here, what's happening today. They reject the truth. They reject the Lord Jesus Christ. So now I'm being led to think they're all demonically possessed. That's what Matthew 12's telling me. But these spirits, we've got multiple spirits within the one man. A man is his house. So a house is a man. A man is a house, right? But we've got multiple entities here within the one man. So what are they? What are they? What are those spirits? Are they stars? Are they angels? Are they celestial bodies? Are they the host, right? We've got spirits, the unclean spirit. So we come back to 1 Kings 22, and we've got all the hosts of heaven are on his right hand and on his left, potentially light and dark. These are the unclean spirits, and he's used this lying spirit. I'm being led to think an unclean spirit, because all the hosts of heaven are there, even the unclean spirits for me. So what's an angel, right? What's an angel? What's a spirit? And what's a star? And are they all pertaining to the same thing? So we come back into Zechariah 13:7, and I'm being led to think that's what we're getting here. We're getting potentially a spirit, the Lord of hosts, because we know that God is a spirit, right? Now, I know it's a very, very contentious point within the scriptures, but I am of the view quite firmly at this point. When I say firmly, it's really what's coming in hard. It's what's coming in hard. If I'm presented with evidence to the contrary, I'll absolutely listen to it, particularly if it's in a scripture. I will absolutely listen to it. But I'm of the view quite now, quite strongly, that the Lord Jesus Christ is God in the flesh. One of the reasons I do think that, not least of all John 1, but also if God wanted to come as flesh, what would that look like? And for me, it happened. It happened. The only one that could fulfill the law, that could defeat death, was God himself. Was God himself. And he came in the flesh. And for me, we're getting a manifestation of this, that the shepherd is the Lord Jesus Christ. And this is a prophecy to the Lord Jesus Christ's crucifixion. He being the shepherd and he being the fellow of the Lord of the celestial bodies, right? So we've got the spirit of the man, the flesh of the spirit, right? That's what I'm being led to think we're looking at here. That's what Zechariah 13:7 for me tells us. So now when we come back into Psalm 80, I'm being led to think we could be talking about the Lord Jesus Christ, the spirit of the flesh, right? In Zechariah 7, he being the shepherd of Israel. But Psalm 80 is all about the children of Israel, this vine, right, which I'm going to get to in just a sec. It's pertaining to the children of Israel being brought forth out of the land of Egypt, which was the Lord God, right? So it's just another reason where the scriptures are just, all of it just leads me to think that the Lord God is actually the Lord Jesus Christ. It was the Lord Jesus Christ all along.
One perfect day, we'll be out walking. Something is calling me. Whoa. This perfect day, I can't stop thinking. Are you over there? Are you?